I looked at the other selections and found that I'd already preached on most of those here, and I'm sure you remember those in the past 4 years. So I thought, you know, it's time to tackle the Romans text. And so if you're sleepy this morning, you're going to miss the whole thing. It's one of those that you've got to, it's one of those that you're going to take home with you this morning and ponder for the rest of the week, I'm sure. But when I read it, I mean, it reminded me of a time years ago when I was growing up on the river in South Bend, where the Clear Fork River empties into the Brazos River as a kid. That place was a perfect place to play. In fact, my brother and I were told that if we didn't get out of the house and go play, we would be put to work. And so that was a no-brainer. We always made a mad dash down to the river to go and play with only one rule. I had one rule. Stay away from the river. Stay away from the river. You know, I can't even do that as an adult. I don't know why Mom thought we could do that. But anyway, so off to the river we would go. But you know, if it was winter time, then things were a little bit different. Because sometimes, even in our neck of the woods, the river would be frozen over. And I remember one time, I had a friend with me. It was not my brother at this time, but I had a friend with me, and we headed down to the river, and the river was iced over completely, and that's pretty rare. But what happens when the river is iced over completely, it opens up adventure for you. It opens up places that were off limits before because you couldn't get to them because of the water. And so what we would do, we would go out on the ice a little ways, and we would stomp real hard, or we would jump up and down to test the ice. You know, we weren't dumb. You know, we had to check the ice to make sure it would hold you up, you know. And so when we find out that it would hold you up, we would go a little bit farther and a little bit farther. And, you know, we had to test the limits, and just to see how far we could go, what we could get ourselves into. So we go farther and we go farther and we go farther, and we see this and we see that, and then all of a sudden we get to a place where the ice begins to crack. And so we go a little bit farther, and the ice begins to crack a little bit more. And so being experienced ice walkers that we were, we realize the ice is getting thinner and thinner as we go, and it's time to stop and turn around. But the problem is, if you've ever walked out on ice before, once it starts cracking, then you begin to get into trouble. And any bit of pressure that you put on one foot or the other, it's too much. And so, you know, there's not a good choice after that. Once the ice begins to start cracking, there's really not a good choice. If you put pressure on this foot to turn around and go back, it's too much. And so you begin to try to slide your feet back and forth, you know, so you don't have to pick them up. But even sliding, you're putting too much pressure. So the last thing, so when you've run out of choices, you know, all your good choices you left on the shore. And so the last thing that went through my mind before my leg went through the ice, Mom told me not to do this. I knew better than to go out on this. I always know better than to go out on the ice. But there's just something about ice that causes you, that draws you out there, especially as a little boy. You know, because if it's strong enough, then you can go ice skating and you can do all kinds of things. But it makes me wonder, why did I do it? Why did I do it? I just couldn't help myself. And you know, that's what Paul is trying to get across in our text this morning. This is Paul's talking about his experience of his own life and the inner struggle that all Christians have going through life. writes this to the letter, in his letter to the Romans. And when it comes to sin, there is no good choice. We left that on the shore of the Garden of Eden. We live in an Adam's world now. A world of sin, a world of consequences, to which we are addicted to. We can't help ourselves. And so in our text, Paul laments about this no-win situation that he's in. For I do not do the good that I want to do, but the evil I don't want to do is what I do. And so let's take a look at what Paul says here. Turn to chapter 7, if you will. Romans 7, beginning with verse 15, and we'll read through verse 25. Hear the word of the Lord. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self. But I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, I guess that was as clear as mud. You know, Paul's theme here is the Jewish law. The Torah. Verse is the renewal of the covenant in Jesus Christ. Paul explains that the law is good, for it points out the wrong that we do. Before the law, I didn't know that that to be in deep desire of my neighbor's new boat or my neighbor's new car or my neighbor's house or my neighbor's wife, I didn't know that that was wrong. But now that I know what the law says in Exodus 20, verse 17, that states, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Now that I know that, I'm convicted of my sin. The problem of what Paul is trying to say here, now that we know it, the sin has taken up residence within us, within me. And I want to sin all the more. Paul states in verse 16, now if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. Basically, the law did what it was supposed to do. It pointed out my sin. Don't cut it. Don't go on the ice. But how do I deal with this sin? We want what we aren't supposed to have. It's just our human nature. As good as the law is for pointing out our sin and for suggesting we strive toward a righteous life or a moral living, if you will, but the law doesn't cure the sin. It just points it out. And it sure makes it impossible to follow. Paul says in verse 18, for I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. You know, Martin Luther wrestled with this same issue in one of his famous writings called The Bondage of the Will. which he wrote against the humanist scholar and devout Christian Eremus of Rotterdam. Eremus argued that for free will, he said, God would have given humans the commandments if we didn't have the freedom and the ability to obey or disobey them. And in his response, Luther argued, yes, we are free to choose to do or not do certain things. But, Luther says, we are not free to choose to be something that we are not. We are not free to choose to be something that we are not. And then Luther went on to explain that a pig may want to fly, but a pig can't fly. Pigs just don't fly. Likewise, sinners may choose or not to choose to do certain things, but sinners can't choose not to sin. It's just a fact. Sinners cannot choose not to sin. We are not free not to sin. We gave that up when we left the Garden of Eden, a God's perfect world for humanity. So we are captive to the power of sin, Paul said. Yet we must continually make choices. And because of this captivity, Paul says, I do not do the good that I want, but the evil I do not want to do is what I do. So we're caught on this thin ice with no place to go. We can't go forward. We can't go backwards. We certainly can't go up. Basically, the only place we can go is down through the ice. Now, the I in this text is the voice of Adam. But it's also the voice of Paul. And it's also your voice. And it's also my voice. It's the voice of all of humanity fallen before we experience God's grace in Jesus Christ. So what Paul does, he lays bare the state of the human soul. When it comes to sin, try as we might, we cannot help ourselves. We always have to test the ice, so to speak. We know what to do. Don't go out on the ice. Don't covet. And you fill in the blank with the sin of your choice. But we just can't seem to do it. And what is worse, the closer that we get to choosing the right, the greater the temptation seems to be. It's not that we're simply weak or lazy, according to Paul, or we're not trying hard enough. Paul says there is a force that dwells within us, that lives within us, that we cannot overpower. Paul understood that the will may be strong, but at the end of the day, the flesh rules. Self cannot rescue itself from sin. The self cannot heal the distorted relationship, cannot cure its self-centeredness by yet more self-exertion. The self, very devised for converting its good intentions, which is the will, into good deeds, which is the flesh, is infected by the sin of self-centeredness. And strangely enough, exerting more energy, more willpower, just draws the self away from God even more. When the ice begins to crack, our instinct is to save ourselves. Our instinct is to push off, to turn around as quick as possible, to panic and to run. But any amount of pressure we exert in trying to turn around and go back or trying to right the wrong causes the ice to crack all the more and give way. It reminded me of a film that came out in 2001 called The Beautiful Mind, or A Beautiful Mind. It's about a brilliant but psychotic mathematician named John Nash. He assures his psychiatrist that he would be able to deploy his analytic skills to cure his own illness. And and this is what his psychiatrist says. He said, you can't reason your way out of this because your mind is where the problem is in the first place. We know the right thing to do. We know the law. We know the moral code for living. We know from experience what happens when we go out on thin ice, so to speak. We just can't stop from doing it. Listen to some of the statistics that I found from the U.S. Substance Abuse and Mental Health Service Administration. Years ago, they gave this report that stated that one out of every eight Americans has significant problems with alcohol or drugs, with 40% of the group having a dual diagnosis or concurrent mental nervous disorder. Approximately 27 million Americans either use illegal drugs regularly or are heavy drinkers. Of these, almost 16 million are estimated to need immediate treatment. By the age of 18, almost 12% of all young people are illegal drug users. Approximately 70% of illegal drug users are employed and contribute significantly to workplace absenteeism, accidents and injuries, decreased productivity, increased insurance expenses, employee turnover costs, and on-the-job violence. The estimated annual direct cost to our society from substance abuse is more than $250 billion. It is generally accepted that chemical dependency, along with associated mental health disorders, has become one of the most severe health and social problems facing the United States today. And we know it's wrong. We know that it kills. We know that it destroys us, and we know that it destroys families, it destroys and corrupts communities. For I do not do the good that I want to, but the evil I do not want is what I do. But you know, Paul tells us that we're not alone in this struggle. Everyone is engaged in this same hopeless battle. Our thin eyes may be just a little bit different than someone else's. But stealing and coveting and greed and gossip and lying and drugs and sex and alcohol and smoking and gluttony and anger and the list could just go on and on and on. This passage, as difficult as it is, it focuses on the universal human failure to resist temptation and the power of sin that is easy to get carried away with. Paul cries out, "Wretched man am I, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord." Paul doesn't simply diagnose the sin-sick state of our soul. He names the cure. The self by itself can neither enact its good intentions or heal its relationship with God. It cannot be rescued, or it can only be rescued from outside of us, namely Jesus Christ, namely through God's grace in Jesus Christ. God's grace restores us to sanity, drawing the self back to God, back to a God-centered salvation instead of our human nature of self-centeredness. My question is, when have you found yourself out on thin ice? Maybe you're there now. Paul spends the whole next chapter, chapter 8, talking about this remedy, this cure. And in Romans 8:11, Paul says this: "If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through His Spirit that dwells in you." That's the remedy. That's the hope. That's the cure for our world, our nation, our inner self. Thanks be to God. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word today.